In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Through the grace of God, we will study now chapter 12 from the first letter of St. Paul to Corinthians. The church at Corinth had many problems. From chapter 1 to 4, St. Paul addressed the problem of the divisions in the church. Chapter 5, St. Paul addressed the problem of the man who committed adultery with his father's wife. In chapter 6, St. Paul discussed the issue and the question whether a Christian should take his brother to the civil courts. Chapter 7, St. Paul answered many questions regarding marriage. From chapter 8 to 10, he answered the question about whether the Christian should eat the meat offered to idols or not. Chapter 12, St. Paul spoke about two issues, head coverings for women inside the church during worship, and also the agape meal, its relation to communion. Now from chapter 12 to chapter 14, 12, 13, and 14, St. Paul begins to address the issue of spiritual gifts, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Because the church at Corinth had division and conflict, and as I said before, there were four groups at Corinth, that's why jealousy and envy characterized the divisions at Corinth. And also, there was abuse of the spiritual gifts, abuse of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. That's why in this chapter, from verse 1 to 11, St. Paul emphasized the importance of unity. Although there is diversity in gifts, many gifts, but all these gifts are coming from the same Spirit, from the same Holy Spirit. And that's why all these gifts should be used for the benefit of everybody and for all. Then actually, in order to bring this concept, to make it easy for them to understand, from verse 12 to 27, he made a comparison between the church and the body. How the body, the human body, has different members and different organs, but all of them function together in harmony. So we, although we have different gifts and we receive different gifts, but we should use these different gifts in harmony together. Then actually, St. Paul closed this chapter, chapter 12, by pointing out that not all serve the same function. Everybody serves according to the gifts that he received. Not everybody has the same gifts. Yes, St. Paul encouraged us to desire the best gifts, but he concluded the chapter by telling them, I will show you more excellent way. And what is this more excellent way? That's actually the way of love. And this what he will discuss in chapter 13. And here, just before we start studying this chapter, I want to differentiate between the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit. What's the difference between the fruits and the gifts of the Spirit? Gifts are tools given to us as gifts from God. Free gifts from God to us, tools to serve one another. We are not going to go to heaven based on the gifts of the Spirit. Actually, many people, although receive the gifts of the Spirit, but they will not go to heaven. As we read in Matthew chapter 7, many people will say to the Lord, in your names we prophesy, in your names we perform miracles, but the Lord will tell them, depart from me, evildoers, I do not know you. So gifts will not qualify us to go to heaven. What will qualify us to go to heaven? That's love. That is the fruit of the Spirit, as we read it in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. So when we bear the fruit of the Spirit, this will qualify us to go to heaven. That's why St. Paul, when he spoke about love, he told them, I will show you the most excellent way. Fruits is the most excellent way. This, the fruit, will qualify you to go to heaven. But gifts, if you don't use it right with the spirit of love, it may disqualify you from going to heaven. So let's start understanding this chapter verse by verse. Verse 1. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. What are the spiritual gifts? Spiritual gifts are gifts given by the Holy Spirit to the church, to the believers. For what purpose? In order to edify the body of Christ for the benefit of all. This is the definition of spiritual gifts. So these are supernatural gifts, gifts given by the Holy Spirit, given to the believers in order to edify the body of Christ. Certain gifts were needed in the early church, especially before they had the New Testament, because the New Testament was collected in the second century. So many gifts were needed, like the gift of prophecy, like the gifts of tongues, were very, very needed in the early church before the collection of the New Testament, and also the gift of miracles for the inauguration of Christianity. Maybe somebody will ask, what is the difference between the gift, the spiritual gift, and the talent? Some people are talented, although they are not Christian. So what's the difference between a talent and a spiritual gift? Of course, talents and gifts are given by God. As Saint James said, every good gift is coming from the Father of lights. So whether I am talented or I receive the spiritual gift, both come from God. But they say the talent is like jewelry box. The gifts, the spiritual gifts, like the toolbox. What's the difference between the jewelry box and the toolbox? And why I say about the talents are like the jewelry box, but the gifts are like the toolbox. If you think about the jewelry, people use it for their own adornment, to adorn themselves. So talents here, I may use the talent for my own benefit, for my own profit. But The gifts, the spiritual gifts, like the tools. Tools are not used for personal adornment, but tools are used to serve one another. As St. Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another, as good steward of the manifold grace of God. So I receive gifts to help you, and your gifts, you use them to serve me. So we are serving one another. For what purpose? For edifying the body of Christ. To edify the body of Christ. That's the main difference between the talents that maybe non-Christians have talents, but the gifts, spiritual gifts, are given only to the Christians who are baptized and receive the Holy Spirit, and they receive these gifts to serve one another in order to edify the body of Christ. That's why he told them, now you have gifts, and I don't want you to be ignorant. Concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. So I will teach you about the spiritual gifts in order to use them properly. Verse 2. You know that you worship idols carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Now, he is elaborating about the word ignorant. When he told them, I don't want you to be ignorant, he's speaking about they were ignorant in regarding to spiritual gifts. So they are ignorant in this area only, this field only, regarding spiritual gifts. Why they were ignorant? Because they worship idols. They worship idols from the heathen, pagan, and now converted from paganism to Christianity. So their past heathen state, wherein they had no experience of the spiritual gifts, of the spiritual power. That's why they were ignorant. During this time, when they were Gentiles, pagan, actually they used to worship dumb idols. Why he used the word dumb? Dumb means they have no power. There is no gifts. Idols cannot give any gifts because they are dumb. Just stone or gold or silver. So there is no comparison between these pagan gods and the true God. And they were led by the priests of the pagan idols. And they were carried, they were led without thinking, without considering that these gods are dumb gods. Just they are worshipping piece of stone or piece of gold or piece of silver. Verse 3. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now how they differentiate and distinguish between false prophets and true prophets, between false priests, like the priests of the idols, and true priests. He told them, if anybody did not confess that Jesus is God and calls Jesus accursed, then this spirit is not the Spirit of God. I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. It is impossible for anybody who has the Spirit of God in him, who has the Holy Spirit in him, to call Jesus accursed. And no one can say Jesus is God except by the Holy Spirit. So in order to profess that Jesus is God, Jesus is the Lord, you need to have the Holy Spirit in you. So if a heathen priest professed to speak by the Spirit, by the Holy Spirit, but called Jesus a curse, then you should know that this priest is a false priest. He doesn't have the Spirit of God. And if one pronounced Jesus as God, then actually he has the Holy Spirit. Because this confession is moved by the Holy Spirit. That's why we differentiate between in the different denominations. Some denominations, we don't call them Christians. But some denominations, we call them Christians. Based on what? Based on whether they profess Jesus Christ as God or not. And I want to bring to your attention that three denominations, we don't call them Christians because they don't believe in the divinity of Christ. Jehovah's Witness, Mormons, and Seventh-day Adventists. These three denominations, they are not Christians because they don't confess that Jesus Christ is God. And as St. Paul said, no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So if they do not confess that Jesus is God, then we cannot call them Christians. Verse 4. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. Now, St. Paul starts to address the issue of spiritual gifts. And he will name actually 9 different gifts. So he said, there are diversity of gifts given to the church by the same Spirit, by the same Holy Spirit. They are various. They are different. There is diversity based on the needs of the church. But all these gifts are coming from the same source, the Holy Spirit. There are diversity of gifts, but the same Spirit. Verse 5. There are different ministries, but the same Lord. In the church, there are different ministries. The ministry of Sunday school, the ministry of the choir, the ministry of agape, the ministry of the board, the ministry of the deacons, the ministry of visitation. Different ministries. But all these ministries are moved and directed by the same Lord and for the same Lord. Verse 6, and there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. So, although we have different ministries, different activities, activities like, you know, conventions, like retreats, like conferences, like trips, field trips, there are different activities. Here St. Paul is warning us to brag about a certain activity or a certain ministry, or actually to look down on a certain activity or a certain ministry. That's why he said, different gifts, different ministries, different activities, but from the same Spirit, same Lord, same God. And he used here the Holy Trinity. In verse 4 said, same Spirit. Usually the word Spirit refers to the Holy Spirit. Verse 5 said, the same Lord. St. Paul, when he used the word Lord, he refers to the Son, Jesus Christ. Verse 6, he said, the same God. God, in the writing of St. Paul, usually he refers to the Father. So he said it is the same Holy Spirit, the same Son, the same Father, the same Holy Trinity. So whether you are serving in the committee of Adair, or Sunday school, or deacons, or visitation, or any activity, you are serving the same God, as he says in verse 6, it is the same God who works all in all. So don't think that you are better than others because you are a deacon and others are not deacon. Or don't think that you are inferior than others because you serve by cleaning the church and not in teaching. It is the same Spirit, it is the same Lord, it is the same God. There is no service better than other service. Actually, what will make you better is not the quality of the service. It's your faithfulness and your wisdom. Maybe the person who cleans the church will go to heaven before a leader in the church. So it is how much faithfulness and how much wisdom you use in your service that will make you better or worse, not the type of the service that you are serving. That's why he said it is the same God who works all in all. Verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. And here, go back to the analogy of the tools box. Why God give me gifts? If God give me the gift of teaching, why God give me this gift? Not to brag, not to tell you I'm better than you, I have better knowledge than you, I can teach you. No, no. This gift is given to me to serve others. And your gifts to serve others, to serve one another, for the profit of all. It's not for my own adornment, otherwise it'd be like the jewelry box. But it is for the profit of all. He makes clear in verse 7, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For the profit of all. And here also, very important word in verse 7, to each one. Nobody can claim that he did not receive a gift. If you are a Christian and you are baptized, then actually you received at least one gift. You received at least one gift. Some people received more than one gift. But at least as a Christian, you received one gift. And you should know what is your gift and use it for the profit of all, to edify the body of Christ. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. So it is one divine source, the Holy Spirit, accounts for spiritual gifts diverse in their manifestation, different in their manifestation. However, these manifestations are different and varied. All are given to every man, every person, every believer, for the profit of all. So, I can say, no gift of the Spirit is given for the benefit of the recipient. For my own personal gain, for my own personal benefit. No. The gifts of the Spirit are not given for any personal gain, or for any personal profit, or for any personal benefit. It is given for the profit of all. From verse 8, he starts to mention 9 different gifts. Verse 8, he said, for to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. So in verse 8, he mentioned 2 gifts, the gift of wisdom and the gift of knowledge. What is the gift of wisdom? The gift of wisdom is the ability to reveal divine truth. In the ability to discern, and you say, this is the word of God. This is the divine truth. No, this is falsehood. So wisdom is given as a gift from God. The gift of knowledge is the ability to teach without error. Like when God, the Holy Spirit, inspired the apostles to write the whole scripture. We can say this is the gift of knowledge, because the authors of the scripture wrote the scripture without any error. That's why we believe in the infallibility of the scripture. That is the gift of knowledge. God gave them knowledge to write, and the Holy Spirit holds them from making any errors while they were writing the whole scripture. Verse 9, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit. So he mentioned two other gifts. In verse 8, he mentioned wisdom and knowledge. In verse 9, he mentioned faith and healing. What's faith? Many people confuse faith as a virtue and faith as a gift. Many people confuse faith as virtue and faith as gifts. Faith as virtue, any believer should have this faith. And this faith comes through healing, as we read in Romans chapter 10, verse 17. But there is faith as a gift. Faith as a gift has power to do miracles. That's why the Lord said, if you have faith like mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will happen. Here the Lord is not speaking about faith as a virtue. Because many people say, no, I cannot move mountain, then I don't have faith, I'm not a believer. No. Here you need to differentiate between faith as gift and faith as virtue. Faith as virtue comes through healing. When you hear the word of God and you believe in God, that's faith as virtue. But there is gift called the gift of faith. It's not given to everybody. Some people receive this gift, and through the gift of faith, they are able to do miracles, to move mountains, through the gift of faith. And then he mentioned in verse 9 the gift of healing. What's the difference between miracles and healing? I can say every healing is a miracle, but not every miracle is healing. Like feeding the multitude, this was a miracle, not a healing. But healing the man who was born blind, this is a healing. So there is difference between the gift of miracles, working miracles through faith, and the gift of healing. Then so far he mentioned four gifts: wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing. Verse 10, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirit, to another kinds of tongue, to another interpretation of tongues. So here he mentioned five gifts in verse 10. Miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirit, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. So now there are five miracles. The gift of faith can be shown in miracles, but faith also can be shown in different activities other than miracles. Like in evangelism, in preaching, you know. That's why St. Paul actually differentiated between the gift of faith and the gift of working miracles. As he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13, though I have all faith, chapter 3, verse 2, though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountain, but have not love, I am nothing. That's about the gift of faith. Miracles is to work miracles in the name of Jesus Christ, like cast out demons. Prophecy, what is the gift of prophecy? To speak words inspired by the Holy Spirit. Like, do you know the story of Agabus, who hold the girdle of St. Paul and said, the Holy Spirit says that the person who has this girl will be arrested by the Jews in Jerusalem. So this was the gift of prophecy. The Holy Spirit inspired Agabus to prophesy about what will happen to St. Paul when he goes to Jerusalem. The discerning of spirit, it is the power of reading hearts and determining whether men spoke by the divine spirit or by some other impulse. So some people, they can discern the spirit. You heard about Paul Cronus. He had this gift of discerning the spirit. He was able to read the hearts and the mind of the people and to tell the people what they want to ask him even before they speak to him. That's the gift of discerning the spirit. Gift of tongues, it's very clear to speak in tongues. And in chapter 14, St. Paul will talk about this gift in detail. But here, just quickly, I want to mention that tongues are non-language, as St. Paul made it clear in chapter 14. The tongues are non-languages. But sometimes, people, when they spoke in tongues, the audience didn't understand them. For example, if somebody received gift to speak in Chinese tongue, in order to reach China. Now, if he speaks in Chinese tongue, you will not understand, because we don't understand Chinese language. That's why there was another gift called the interpretation of tongues, the ability to explain the meaning of tongues. So St. Paul now mentioned 9 different gifts: wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, discerning of spirit, tongues, interpretation of tongues, and prophecy. So he mentioned 9 different gifts. But all these gifts are imparted and given by the same Spirit. So here he gives us example, diversity of gifts. He mentioned 9 different gifts, but all these gifts are given by the same Spirit. Verse 11. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. As he wills. Again, St. Paul emphasizing that this gift distributed to each one individually. So each one of you received at least 1 gift. But who determines who receives what? Who decides which gift you receive? It is God. That's why he said, as he wills. As he wills, he refers to God. So these gifts are distributed according to his own will, to the will of God. That's why if I receive a prominent gift, or a supernatural gift, I shouldn't brag about it. If I receive gift of miracles or healing, I should not brag about this gift, because I have no credit in earning this gift. It's given by God to me for the profit of all. And if a person receives a less prominent gift, he shouldn't feel inferior to others. Because, again, that's what God decided. Which one receives what gift? After St. Paul, in these 11 verses explain to us like how gifts are distributed to each one by according to the will of God, and there is diversity of gifts, but same Spirit, same Lord, same God. Now, St. Paul from verse 12 to 31 will make comparison between the body, the human body, and the body of Christ. Verse 12. For as the body is one and has many members, but all members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. So also is Christ means so also is the body of Christ, the church, the assembly of the believers. He said the unity of these diverse gifts is illustrated, and you can understand it better if you look to your human body. Your human body has many members: brain, heart, liver, kidney, spleen, stomach, lung, different members, different organs. And these different organs have different function. But all these organs are parts of the same body. In the same way, we are different members, different organs in the body of Christ, with different functions, based on the different gifts. But all of us are the same body, the body of Christ. Verse 13. For by one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. St. Paul said, by means of one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. By the same Spirit, we are baptized into the same body, into one body, the body of Christ. Whether we are Jews or Greek, whether we are Gentiles, whether we are slaves or free. That's why we say, before baptism you are individual. But after baptism, you become a member. Before baptism, you are individual, a separate entity. But after baptism, you are not individual, you are not a separate entity. You are part of the body of Christ. You are member in the body of Christ. So through baptism, you change from being individual. Individual means undividable. In, non, individual means dividable. So individual, non-dividable, I cannot share my life with others. Before baptism, you are undividable. You cannot be divided with others, you cannot be shared with others. But after baptism, you become part of the body of Christ. By one Spirit, we are born again from the water and the Spirit in baptism. So by being born again from water and the Spirit in baptism, we are all baptized into one body. So, though diverse in race, whether we are Jews or Gentiles, and condition, whether we are bond or free, all have been made parts of the one body, the body of Christ, by baptism. And this has been done under the direction of the Holy Spirit, because it is the Holy Spirit who descends on the waters of baptism and makes us born again of the Spirit. And all receiving gifts from the same Spirit. How? When we are anointed by the Mayrub, by the chrism, and we receive the Spirit of God and ask the Holy Spirit, you are the temple of God and the Holy Spirit abides in you. Here you receive also gift from the Holy Spirit. That's why he said, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit, to drink into one Spirit. You remember in the Gospel of St. John, when the Lord Jesus Christ said, if anybody is thirst, come to me and rivers of living water will flow from him. And St. John commented on this by saying he was speaking about the Holy Spirit. So when he said, drink into the Holy Spirit, he's speaking here about chrismation. How through the anointment of my rule, you drink the living water, the Holy Spirit, and now you are a temple of the Holy Spirit, and thus you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So through baptism and chrismation, we are one body, the body of Christ, but we receive diversity of gifts. Verse 14, for in fact, the body is not one member, but many. Like your body is not only arm, it's not only brain, it's not only heart. You cannot have a body like this. The body is not one member, but many members. In the same way, the body of Christ is not only one member, but many members with diversity of gifts, ministries, and activities. So, St. Paul now is going to say, no member could claim that it was not of the body because it is not the eye or some other organ. For example, your ear cannot say, I am not part of this body because I am not the eye. The eye cannot say, I am not part of the body because it's not the nose. In the same way, you cannot say, I am not part of the body of Christ because I am not a Sunday school teacher. You cannot say, I am not part of the body of Christ because I am not a deacon. You cannot say, I am not part of the body of Christ because I am not a board member. No, it's diversity of gifts. Each one of us is part of this body, and each one of us is necessary for the body of Christ. But who decided that this person served this capacity? That's God, the Holy Spirit. And we all together make the same body, the body of Christ. Verse 15. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And St. Paul actually chose the foot here because like it is a humble organ in the body. So if the humble organ in the body is piece of more honorable member in the body, and he said, if I am not this, in this honor, I am not of the body. So, does it make it not of the body? Then he said in verse 16, and if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? So, ear is more humble than the eye, foot is more humble than the hand. So, St. Paul is trying to say here, those who receive less prominent gifts or serving in a more humble capacity, they shouldn't feel jealous and shouldn't feel inferior of the more honorable members in the body of Christ. And again, what makes the difference is not the quality of your gift. It's not being hand or not being foot, but what makes the difference, how faithful and how wise you are in using the gift. Maybe foot and hand represent men of active life, because foot and hand move and do several activities. Eye and ear represent contemplative life, like the servants and the monks. So foot and hand represent those who serve in the world. Eye and ear represent those who are living in desert in a more contemplative life. So superior as the eye is, it would not do if it were the sole member to the exclusion of the rest. If your body is only eye, there is no body. If your body is only hand, it's not body. That's what St. Paul said in verse 17. If the whole body were an arm, where would be the hearing? If the whole body were hearing, where would be the smell? So we need one another. And St. Paul actually will elaborate more about how the humble members, God gives them more honorable place. So God actually honors the humble members more, as St. Paul will explain. So the body cannot be only eye, cannot be only ear, cannot be only nose. Verse 18, but now God has set the members, each one of them in the body, just as he pleased. And again, St. Paul emphasizes more and more, it is God who decides who do what. This is the decision of God, according to what pleases him, according to his own wisdom, according to his own will. It is God who decides who do what in the body. Sometimes, especially during the board nomination, we see some people get upset and get angry. Why am I not chosen as to be a board member? Why? You can serve in any capacity. If God chose you to be a board member, then you can serve in this capacity. If God did not choose you to be a board member, you can serve in different, in other capacities. It doesn't matter. Why we fight like the church in Corinth about certain positions? Actually, if we are fighting for certain positions, maybe while you want to use these gifts for our own glory, not for the glory of God. But actually, if I understand that I can serve in any capacity, and it doesn't matter in what capacity I'm serving, I will be happy with whatever capacity God gives me, as long as I'll be faithful and I'm wise in using this gift for the glory of God. This should not create tension in the Church of God. This should not create conflict between the different members during the time of the nominations, especially for the board. Verse 19. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? And here, St. Paul is emphasizing the idea of the teamwork. Some people, they want to run the whole show. For example, if I'm servant, or I am in a certain capacity, I don't want to do everything. I don't give opportunity to other persons to serve with me. But St. Paul said, if you are serving with this mentality, then actually this is not the body of Christ. Because the body of Christ has many members. It's not only one member. Like your body is not only one member. You cannot run the whole show by yourself. You cannot. You cannot, in any capacity, try to push everybody away from you. If you are doing this, then actually you are serving your own glory. You want to be only in the picture. But the real member in Christ should actually allow everybody to participate with him. That is the teamwork. But if you are serving only by yourself and not allowing anybody to serve with you, and you are just excluding anybody from serving with you, this mentality is not the mentality of the members of the body of Christ. That's why he said, if they were one member is doing everything, where would be the body? Then the concept of the body disappeared. Verse 20, but now indeed there are many members, yet one body. So, yet one body because of unity. So, we are several members, but we should not fight with one another. When we have like two servants in the same class, or two churches in the same city. Many times we hear about conflict between the churches, between the priests, between the servants. This is not the body of Christ. Actually, we should serve together in harmony and in unity to complement one another and to complete one another. But if we are fighting, and if I want to increase and you decrease, this is not the spirit of the body of Christ. In the body of Christ, everybody say, I must decrease and we should increase. Not the opposite, I must increase and you should decrease. Or, I cannot just separate myself from others. And that's another type. Maybe in my class, I will separate my class from the rest of some school. Or I separate my church from the rest of other churches. This is not again the body of Christ. Where is the unity? Actually, in our body, there is a tissue called connective tissue. Connective means to connect. And what's the connective tissue in the body of Christ? That's actually the love. The bond of love connects all the churches, all the members together. So I cannot just separate my church or my service or my ministry from other ministries and I say I'm in the body of Christ. If I'm serving with this mentality, this is not the body of Christ. That's why St. Paul said, yes, many members, yet one body. One body. Verse 21. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again head to the feet, I have no need of you. St. Paul is warning us here from being arrogant. Maybe I am in a prominent position in the church, and you are in a less prominent position in the church. So I am like the head, and the eye, and St. Paul said here, eye and hand. So I'm the eye, you are the hand. I'm living a contemplative life, and you are serving. I am in the monastery serving the God, that's the I, and you are serving in the world. So I cannot say, I have no need of you. Monks cannot say to the servants, I have no need of you. Actually, monks need the servants, and the servants need the monk. Nor again the head to the feet. Those who are leaders cannot say to those who are helpers, I have no need of you. So this arrogance should not be in the body of Christ. Because every member of the body has its place and needed by every other member in the body of Christ. Verse 22. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. St. Paul said the members are weak, who are weaker, who are more delicate, or tender structure are necessary. Like in your body, the veins, the arteries, are very weak, very delicate, but they are very, very important. So St. Paul is telling us, those who appear like the weaker members in the body of Christ, they are very, very essential in the body of Christ. And those members of the body, verse 23, which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor, and our unpresentable parts have greater modesty. So, the weaker, like those who are delicate, like the veins and the arteries, what are the members that we think less honorable? Maybe like the feet. Maybe we think about our feet and belly less honorable. But actually he said, these members in the body, which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor. We put shoes on the feet, and actually we put clothes to cover the belly. And the unpresentable members or unpresentable parts, the secret members, in the body, have greater modesty by the help of the rest. We cover them. So St. Paul is trying to say, in this week, or these dishonorable, or these unpresentable parts, God gives them greater honor or modesty. In the same way, in the body of Christ, we should give more honor to those who are serving in the less prominent capacities. Verse 24, but our presentable parts have no need, because they are presentable. They are already prominent, so they don't need any more honor. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks. So St. Paul is actually setting a very important rule here. Those who are serving in a prominent capacity, they don't need more honor. Actually, we need to honor those who are serving in a lower capacity. And actually, unfortunately, we do exactly the opposite. We usually, when we do a celebration, we do a celebration for whom? For our leaders. So those who are presentable, we honor them more and more, but they are honored. God is teaching us, if we want to honor, we have to honor those who are serving in less honorable and less prominent areas in the church. So I wish one time the church honors, make like a celebration especially, to honor those who are serving in a secret service, in hidden services, less honorable services. مثلا ما سمعتش كنيسة عملت حفل مثلا للفراشين اللي بيخدموا فيه. بالرغم ان ده تعليم الكتاب المقدس. That's what we need to do. That's what St. Paul is saying us. Having given greater honor to that part which lacks. Because those who are presentable and honorable, they already have honor because of their position. They don't need more honor. Who needs more honor? Those actually who are serving in less capacity, in the less honorable situation. And I hope this teaching of St. Paul sitting in our minds in order to honor and give more reverence to the people who are lacking this, which lack this. And we need actually to care for them and to serve them. So the noble in the church should care of the less honorable and serve the less honorable. Verse 25. That there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. Why St. Paul is saying all of this about the honorable members and the dishonorable members and who should receive glory and who should receive honor? Why is he saying all this? He said that there is no schism in the body, no division, no disunion. One thing that really, really hurts St. Paul and hurts every spiritual leader when he sees division in the church. Because if there is division and schism in the church, this means the absence of God. God called us in unity. That's why St. Paul, he said, I am teaching you about the spiritual gifts, so that the divisions and the conflict in this church may disappear. To know how to care for one another, as he said, the members should have the same care for one another. We should actually use our gifts, use our services in order to serve one another and to care for one another. Why? To preserve the whole body for the profit of the whole body. When we care for one another, the whole body of Christ will be preserved and will grow and will enjoy this profit. Verse 26. If one member suffers, I cannot say it's not my business. If we are members, like in your body, if one member suffers, all the members suffer with him. So all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. St. John Chrysostom said, all members regard the affected member with intense keys. So when somebody goes through a difficult time, always go with him through the difficult time. And when other member is honored, we don't feel jealous. Actually, all of us, we rejoice with him. When the head is crowned, the whole man feels honor. The mouth expresses, the eye looks gladness, as St. John Chrysostom said. So, if we feel that we are members in the same body, then we will not be jealous of one another. If my brother is honored, this makes me happy. I will rejoice. I will not feel jealous if my brother is honored. Verse 27. Now you are the body of Christ and members individually. St. Paul again is repeating the same concept. You are the body of Christ, one body. It's not the bodies, not the temples. It's one body. You are the body of Christ and members individually. But each individual is a member. So each individual becomes a member. But all of us, all who were baptized into one body, but who are several members of several parts of the same body, and we received different gifts to use them like the different organs of the body. Verse 28, God has appointed these in the church. Now St. Paul, after he spoke about nine gifts in the beginning of the chapter, now he will speak about nine positions in the church. Nine positions. And to each position, God granted certain gifts. And here, before I read the nine positions, some positions disappeared, did not exist. And also some gifts disappeared and did not exist. Why? Does not exist now. Why? Because there is no need for them. God gives this gift in a certain time because they will need it. But if we don't need this gift, God will not give this gift. For example, in verse 28, God has appointed these in the church. First, apostles. Now, there is no apostles. So, in the early Christianity, we needed apostles to establish churches. But now, there is no need for apostles. That's why this position disappeared. Who are the apostles? The apostles are the 12, the 72. St. Paul also is considered one of the apostles. And of course, Barnabas and the evangelists are considered among the 72. So the apostle, people who are sent, who are carrying epistle, the apostle messenger, a person who has an epistle, has a message, men sent by God by the Holy Spirit, to preach the gospel. That's the definition of the apostle. Person who sent by God to preach the gospel. Second, prophets. As you said, prophet, those who speak by the Holy Spirit. And I give you the example of Agabus, the prophet. Teachers. Teachers are those who receive the gift of teaching by the Holy Spirit to teach others, to interpret the scripture. Miracles, those who have the power to work miracles. And we differentiate between miracles and healing. I told you, miracles like removing mountain, like feeding the multitude. This is miracle. The gift of healing. Healing, miraculous power to heal the diseases. Helps. What he means by helps? Helps those who help others. There are leaders and there are helpers. So, some people serve as helper. Maybe they do not receive the gift of leaders, but they are serving as helper. And also they receive a spiritual gift from the Holy Spirit to aid them and to help them as helpers. Administrations. And here administration is a spiritual gift. Some people say, I want to serve in a spiritual area, not in administrative area. This is confusion. whose administration is a spiritual gift. You cannot say this is a spiritual service, but this is administrative service. You cannot say this. Every administrative service is also spiritual service because it's given by the Holy Spirit. It's a spiritual gift. So administrative, like administrative abilities, like those person who serving in the board, those who arrange activities, trips, convention, that's administrative. Tongues, variety of tongues. Those who are speaking in different tongues to preach. For example, Saint Mark, when he came to Egypt, has to speak in the Coptic tongue in order to preach the Egyptians. Otherwise, how they would understand him. So, Saint Paul mentioned 9 positions here: apostles, prophets, teachers, miracles, healing, helps, administrations, tongues. Apostle, prophet, teachers, miracles, healing, helps, administration, tongues. Actually, 8. He spoke about 8. Then in verse 29. Verse 29 are very, very important. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? St. Paul is saying, not everybody has to receive all gifts. Not everybody is an apostle. Not everybody is a prophet. Not everybody is a teacher. Not everybody works miracles. Why I'm saying this is important? Some people actually, they measure the holiness of a person by whether he is doing miracles or not. So, if he does miracles, then he is a saint. If he doesn't do miracles, then he is not a saint. I want to tell you, some people perform miracles and not saints. Judas Iscariot actually performed miracles. He received the gift of miracles as one of the 12. But he does. And it's not necessary for everybody to make miracles in order to be a saint. What makes you a saint? When you bear the fruit of the Spirit, not the gift of the Spirit. The Pentecostal church says, if you are filled with the Spirit, you need to speak in tongues. That's absolutely wrong. If you are filled with the Spirit, you need to bear the fruit of the Spirit. Because speaking tongue is a gift, not fruit. That's why in verse 30, he said, do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongue? Do all interpret? No. So, actually, he forces the people to speak in tongues. And actually, they don't speak in non-tongues. So this is not a gift at all of the Spirit. It's nonsense. I cannot say what happens is the gift of the Spirit. It's not. Because there is no need now for tongues. And St. Paul made it clearly that do all speak with tongues. So how can I say if you are filled with the Spirit, you must speak in tongues? No. If you are filled with the Spirit, you must bear the fruit of the Spirit, not the gifts of the Spirit. So tongues are not a sign of being filled with the Spirit. Verse 31. But earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I show you a more excellent way. So, it is the Spirit of God who divides to every man as he wills. But St. Paul actually, he said, although according to the will of God, he distributes the gifts, but this doesn't prevent men from earnestly seeking by prayer and watchfulness the greatest gifts. But when you desire greatest gift, you should desire it to serve others, not for your own glory. For example, if a person went to a church and he found the church doesn't have any teachers. For example, he went to a far country, and in this area, there is nobody who teaches. He may pray and ask the Lord to give him the gift of teaching, so he may teach and preach the gospel to those who didn't hear about the gospel. So here he desired the gift of teaching, not for his own glory, but actually for the profit of all. So when there is a lack, when there is a need, here you may pray for a certain gift in order to serve others for the profit of all, not for your own glory. But after St. Paul spoke about the gifts, he said, although I recommend you desire the greatest gift to serve others and for the profit of all, but I will show you a more excellent way, the way of love, the way of the fruit of the Spirit, because the fruit of the Spirit is more excellent way. This is what will qualify us to go to heaven, not the fruit of the Spirit, not the gifts of the Spirit. Many people will receive the gift, but if they don't use them properly, they may actually be lost. Glory be to God forever and ever. Do you have any questions here about the chapter? Yes, I am. Yes, sir.
من المعروف فلسطين انك من المجموعه اللي هنا امريكان بيفهموا في الانجليزي 100% ما فيهمش زي حالات ولو 10 او
20%. عدناها انا وابن يوحنا ثمن عذاب العربي. فيعني لما بتدفع عذاب الانجليزي للناس اللي هم يعني عايزين يسمعوا الانجليزي يعني ما بطلعش. لا انا عندي ثمن عذاب العربي.
العفو الكبير يا سيادنا بس انا شخصيا اول مره احضر
لا لا حضرت معايا كاس عزيزي بالعربي. لا حضرت معايا. في تراجع معاهم بس. يس يس يا كوشن.
How is the correct way for us to identify our gift? To know what gift we have?
To identify your gift, there are 5 points. Quickly. Number one, to believe that you have a gift. Because some people say, I didn't receive any gift. You will not start searching for your gifts unless you believe that you have a gift. Number two, actually, to pray and ask God to reveal this gift for you. Because it is the Holy Spirit who placed this gift in you. So you need to pray and ask God to reveal what's your gift. Number three, to go and discuss with your spiritual father what are your gifts and how to use them for the glory of God. And one time I did a workshop in small groups, and I asked everybody to write what he thinks that this is his own gift. And then I asked the rest of the group to tell this person what his gift is. So when he hears feedback from others, this also will help him to identify his gift. Maybe somebody will tell you, you know, when you teach, you simplify things, and I really, really understand when you teach. So maybe this feedback from others will tell you that you have the gift of teaching. So number one, believe that you have a gift. Number two, ask the Lord to reveal your gift to you. Number three, discuss with your spiritual fathers what are your gifts and how to use them. Number four, listen to the feedback of others. Number five, be willing to use this gift for the glory of God. Maybe you have the gift of evangelism, and God wants you to send you to China to preach there. But maybe I'm not willing to go and preach there. That's why I'm in denial. I say, no, I don't have this gift. Because I don't want to go and preach. You know? But gifts can be, the example of China is extreme. But maybe you know about computer, for example, and how to design web pages, and it's a big one, I'm not willing to use this gift. You're like, please don't say to Abuna that I understand web pages. When I will tell you a web page, okay. Actually, you are hiding your gift, and you are in denial. And if you don't use your gift, actually, if you have disuse atrophy, it will disappear. If you don't use your gift, why God will give you, will leave it with you? So the willingness to use the gift, this will make you to know what is your gift. So these are the 5 points. believes that you have a gift, ask the Lord, discuss with your spiritual father, listen to the feedback of others, be willing to use the gift for the glory of God and for the profit of all. Any other questions?
Peter, the simple questions. What was the issue of the church that St. Paul in chapter 12 tried to resolve? The مشكلة اللي كانت فيها الكنيسة اللي قصد معرفة بولس الرسول يعرف لك الصعب ده. ايه المشكلة؟ What was the issue? دكتور
There was a different issue between the Corinthians about race, culture, and all of this. And he tried to show them how to be united and unify in the body of Christ.
But the one issue, I think, this, there was a major issue. I think that's how we started in the Sahara.
Was it division?
It was a division resulting from what?
That all the gifts has the same important rules and values, and it's all coming from one spirit and going to one body.
Yeah, I think there were kind of مشكلة أساسا in the mess. They were envying each other because of the gifts. وكل واحد is seeking to have gifts. I want to speak in tongues. Isaac Kellen and Senna, to show off. Basically, that was the whole issue. Everyone seeking glory. This was the story of how the Arab is not for deep. We all, this is not what you ought to see. With Captain Bob, it's not something to brag about. Question 2, explain what St. Paul meant by this verse. For by one spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one spirit.
That before baptism we were individual, but after the baptism we became one body.
This is the right answer. So before baptism we were one individual, but after baptism we became member in the body of Christ. Member in the body of Christ. كل واحد ليه function. Not all the members are the same. فكلنا بنكمل بعض. Through baptism, بقى مفيش حد بقى كبير وحد صغير، مفيش واحد يهودي وبتاع، كلنا بقينا مسيحيين، مفيش عبيد، مفيش أحرار، كلنا أحرار في جسد المسيح، وممبرز كل واحدة ليها كرامات، وكرامات متساوية. آخر واحدة معرفتش سيدنا جاوب عليها في الإصحاح ده، بس يعني أنا كنت ولكن هند للمواهب الحسنى وأيضا تريكم طريقا أفضل. ما هو هذا الطريق الأفضل التي يعني قديس بولس الرسول but earnestly desire the best gifts and yet I show you a more excellent way. What is the more excellent way that St. Paul refers to?
The way of love. If you love other جمال less time in حضرة and or insane gives it نفسه الحب
Right. Right. And the rather the fruits of the spirit rather than how I feel that he wants to show off. وهو طبعا صح الجاي كله بيتكلم على how love builds and applies.
Not only baptism, but the سر المجهول اللي هو الروح القدس إذا الجسم الواحد ومن غير هذا
ما هو خدنا كلنا الروح بس ما حنترين الروح خدنا كلنا الروح الواحد اللي هو بيعطي كل واحد موهبة مختلفة حسب احتياجه فيه. سيدنا كتير دكتور. مرة تانية يعني هو سيدنا بيقول هو هذا كان على الراس نازل هو مش سيدنا هذا 13 حسب فيعني بنشكر سيدنا على محبته الكبيرة وتعليمه لينا الحقيقة يعني غذاء روحي كلنا نستفيد من كل احتياج تعليمنا.